ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। नमः श्री शंकरानंद नमः श्री शंकरानंद गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने गुरुपादाम्बुजन्मने सविलास महामोह सविलास महामोह ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे ग्राहग्रासैककर्मणे। The question was asked in response to the statement Yo vai bhuma tat sukham nalpe sukhamasti, so that which is bhuma meaning the limitless, and therefore advaitam non-dual, because whether duality and limitation both always go together, and therefore the freedom from duality is the same as freedom from limitation, and so bhuma is sukham or happiness. That means the dvaita or the non-dual is happiness. Now, question was asked, if you say that dvaita sukha-bhava, say that in duality or where we experience a limitation, that there is no sukha, no happiness, we accept. But what is the proof that in a dvaita or the non-dual that there is happiness? What's the proof? Then the reason advanced was that if there was happiness in a dvaita or a non-dual, then we would experience it, but we don't experience it. If you say that you will experience the happiness of the non-dual, in that case, that very experience itself involves the triad of the tripudi, of the experiencer, experienced and experienced. So if there were an experience of the happiness that is of the non-dual, the very experience itself would amount to duality, and therefore, how can you say that advaita or the non-duality means happiness? And so the Siddhanta replied, there is no need that you require an experience of the non-dual. Meaning, non-dual cannot become an object of experience like a pot or a book becomes an object of experience. So suppose an object such as music or whatever gives me happiness, then there is, let us say, happiness in music. So in that manner we cannot say that there is happiness in non-dual. Then what is it? Happiness is non-dual. It's not that there is happiness in non-dual, happiness is non-dual. We do not say that the wave is in water, wave is water. We do not say the pot is in clay, pot is clay. And similarly also, it is not that Advaita or the non-dual is the locus of happiness. It is of the nature of happiness. All right. But what is the proof? Kim manam? We say that this non-dual does not require any proof at all. Why is it? Svayam prabhe na mana akanksha. Because Advaita or the non-dual is Svayam prabha, is self-effulgent. And that which is self-signing or self-revealing does not require any other means of knowledge to reveal that. What is a pramanam or a means of knowledge do is that it reveals an object. Like my eyes reveal the object, namely the flower, a rose, or whatever. But when there is a self-shining, Atma shines itself. Advaita is self-shining, and therefore does not require any sense organs of the mind or any means of knowledge to reveal that. And therefore, it is self-revealing, just as we said yesterday. It doesn't require proof for me to establish that I am. That I am, that I exist, is a self-shining or self-revealing fact. I don't require to see myself or hear myself or to feel myself, to experience myself, or do anything about myself to know that I am. Because I am is self-revealing. And similarly, I am Advaita, is self-revealing. All right. How do you say that Advaita is there? So, first of all, we said, okay, the question was asked, if you say that you do not accept the Advaita or the non-dual, then let us ask you this question. What was there before the creation of duality? What we experience or perceive is the world of duality. So we ask a question. What obtained or what existed before the creation of duality? Please tell us. Either it is non-dual that existed, or duality that existed, or something which is other than the dual or the non-dual that could exist. Now something other than dual or non-dual there is no such entity which is different from dual and the non-dual, because only two entities are known to us. So the choice only narrows down to these two, that before the creation of duality, there was either duality or non-duality. Now to say that there was duality before the creation of duality is contradictory, because before creation of duality, how can duality be there? Before the birth of Devadatta, was Devadatta there or his father was there? Naturally, Devadatta cannot exist before his own birth. And so also duality cannot exist before its own creation. Therefore, it is evident that what obtains before the creation of duality is non-dual. Of course, that does not mean that when the duality is there, the non-dual has disappeared. That even when the duality is, non-dual is very much. In fact, the non-dual alone appears as duality. And so non-dual ever is. The duality comes into appearance, remains for a while, and again dissolves. Like the waves appear in the water, remain for a time, and then again it subsides. But the water is before the wave, during the wave, and after the wave. And so also the wave of duality arises in the non-dual. It remains for a while and again subsides. But even when that wave of duality arises, that is what we call creation, the non-dual is before, during and after. However, since there is a question of whether, since we perceive duality, there arises a question whether non-dual is there or not. Therefore, this argument is advanced here. All right, if you have a question as to whether the non-dual is there or not, then think of the situation when the duality has not yet come into appearance, duality has not yet become manifest, then what obtains is naturally non-dual. As we said yesterday, it stands to reason that the very basis or the substratum of the duality must be non-dual. It's very interesting that anything, when you inquire into the nature of anything, it will lead you to non-dual. Take the case of this cloth. What we call cloth, when you analyze, is nothing but cotton. This cloth is nothing but a manifestation or appearance of cotton. And what is cotton? Is nothing but the fibers. And because the effect is nothing but the cause. Cloth is the effect, cotton is the cause, effect is nothing but the cause. And so, you call it cloth from one standpoint. The same thing can be called cotton from another standpoint. And cotton itself is an effect of the fibers. So again, what we call cotton is nothing but fibers. Fibers are again nothing but the molecules from which the fibers are made. And molecules are nothing but atoms. And like this, if you go on and on and on and reducing, where is the limit of reduction? Whereas we said, as Swami likes to say, that what we call the cloth is an adjective of the cotton. And what we call cotton is an adjective of fibers. What we call fibers is an adjective of molecules. So every adjective resolves into substratum or a substantive. And thus if you keep on reducing and reducing and reducing, ultimately it should reduce into that which is not an adjective in itself. Meaning it must be nirgunam or without any qualification. So unqualified. So this non-dual, unqualified, formless, that is where any inquiry will lead us to. That is the substratum of the duality or of all the qualifications, of all the limitations. In this manner, the Siddhanti has shown how the non-dual has to be accepted. Okay. Now we continue the discussion from the verse 27. Nanu uktena prakarena advaitam yuktya eva siddhyati na anubhavena. Alright, in this manner, you have proven that there is non-dual, alright, but that you have proven only by reasoning. But there is no experience of the non-dual. See, these questions are raised with keeping certain thing in mind. Here, in this chapter, the author wants to prove that Brahma is Brahma, which is non-dual, is of the nature of ananda or happiness. And that is sought to be proven by our own experience. And what is the experience? Experience of deep sleep. So now the subsequent discussion is to prove that in the deep sleep what we are experiencing is nothing but the non-dual. And in the deep sleep what we are experiencing also is nothing but happiness. And therefore non-dual, which is Brahma, is happiness. Because this is a chapter on Brahmananda. And therefore it has to be proven how Brahma is, Brahma which is non-dual, is of the nature of ananda or total happiness. And in so establishing, it is established by raising various arguments and answering, raise various questions and answering them. And thus the author goes on, you know, in the process also, he takes the opportunity to explain the phenomenon of deep sleep as explained in the Upanishads. So, Upanishads explain or describe the phenomenon of deep sleep, and that also he takes the opportunity to explain. Thus, this gives us an explanation of what the Upanishads reveal about in deep sleep. It also gives us an understanding of experience of deep sleep, and from that it is proven that what obtains in deep sleep is non-dual, and that is ananda or happiness. So Brahma, which is non-dual, is happiness. This is will be proved after many verses. It will take a few days for us to arrive at that, you know. But in the meantime, we are going through different kinds of arguments. So this is the style of this text here, that the author, he keeps on, you know, what do you call it, meandering, you know. He has an objective, all right, but in by way of proving that objective, he also proves many other things. And thus, we become enriched as we go along with his arguments. And it will, unless we keep the central objective in view, you are likely to be lost also. But we will not be lost. Keeping the central objective in view, we will see how cleverly and nicely the author, in the process of proving what he wants to prove, also gives us a lot of other insights and gives us a lot of other understanding. So now you have to bear with our reasoning. And you have to be somewhat attentive, you know, because as the arguments go on, and they sometimes become little involved. And so it will require a little greater attention. So she says, Nanu, uktena prakarena advaitam yuktya eva siddhati. The Pura Paksha, the opponent, asks a question here. So we are discussing the verse 27. That uktena prakarana, by the manner in which you just said, advaitam yuktya eva siddhati. The advaita, the non-dual, can be proven only by yukti, by the reasoning, okay? You prove by reasoning. And what is the reasoning? What is it that obtained before the creation of duality? Naturally, the non-dual obtains. So non-dual is what obtains in the state of dissolution. But anubhavena, there is no experience of that. You have not proven it by experience. This is what the Purvapakshiya, the opponent, asks. And so, that is how this verse 27 is formed. Says the verse here, Advaita-siddhir-yukyaiva nanubhutyeti-cedvada nanubhutyeti-cedvada nirdrashtanta-sadrashtanta vākotyantara-matrano vākotyantara-matrano. Advaita Siddhi Yuktyayeva Na Anubhutya. This part is what we call Purupaksha, or the opponent asks the question here. Advaita Siddhi Yuktyayeva. That you have arrived at, you have proven that Advaita, the non-dual, is by Yukti, only by reasoning. Na Anubhutya. But that there is no experience of this non-dual. If this is your question, we are asking him now, because you don't know who is saying what, you know. So, here the Purupakshi, the opponent says that the non-dual is proven only by reasoning and not by experience. Then we ask him, all right, if this is what you have to say, then tell us this. Nirdrashtanta sadushtantava kotyantaram atrano. Now you say that the non-dual is proven by reasoning or by argument. Please tell us in the reasoning or argument, there is drishtanta illustration or not. See how the arguments are presented is like this. You want to prove something. The standard statement is, the parvato vandiman dhumatvat. We say that hillock has fire. Why do we say that? Because there is smoke. We don't see the fire. What we see from distance is smoke. But we infer the presence of fire. So this is called yukti or reasoning. So by reasoning or yukti we prove the existence of fire, because we perceive smoke. But you have to establish the connection between smoke and fire. You cannot say just because I see the smoke therefore there is fire. What's the relationship between them? Then you have to prove the relationship. You have to establish the relationship. Yatra yatra dhumaha tatra tatra vannihi. Wherever there is smoke, there must be fire. This is what we call vyapti, or concomitant, or invariable relationship. That wherever smoke is, fire must be. Where did you find it? Yasa mahanase, as in the kitchen. Or in many other places. So in many places we have seen, and so kitchen is our everyday example, that there is smoke coming out of the chimney, because there is fire. There cannot be smoke unless the fire is. There is no rule there. There is no rule that wherever fire is, there smoke must be. We don't say that. But wherever smoke is, fire must be. And this is what we observe in the kitchen and in many other places. So kitchen, not this kitchen here, because we have only this gas. And I'm talking of the olden days kitchen when they were burning wood. So wood stove is an example of fire and smoke being both invariably related. So wood straw becomes what? An illustration. This is called illustration or example. You require an example or illustration to prove your reasoning. Otherwise that is not called reasoning. When you present the argument, wherever smoke is, fire must be there, you must present an illustration, which is acceptable to both the parties. If I quote an illustration that I only know and you never know, or suppose I give an example which you don't accept, then it doesn't become an illustration. So the required condition of the standard illustration is, it must be ubhayavadi sammataha, meaning it must be acceptable to both the parties. And that is called illustration of drashtanta, where there is presence of both the hetu and sadhya. Where there is the presence of both the cause as well as what you want to prove. So hetu is the smoke. Where the smoke is, there must be fire. And we find smoke and fire together. Indeed, that is called drashtanta, that is called the illustration. So kitchen. So any argument, now understand that whenever we make arguments in our day-to-day life also, there are lots of misunderstandings and confusions and fights, because what I consider argument is not considered argument by somebody else. What is called an argument is when it is supported by an illustration, which is acceptable to both the parties, then alone it is called an argument. So having this much understanding, now here we are asking questions, all right? You say that the Advaita is proven by yukti or by argument. Please tell us whether the argument you are presenting in proof of Advaita is with drishtanta, with illustration or without illustration. That's all. So there is no third kotyantaram atrano, and there is no third category. Either Your argument must be with illustration or without illustration. There is no third category. Advaita siddhi yuktyayavadi uktam vikalpa sattvat anupannam. Siddhanta knows that he will not be able to give, you know, will not be able to give an answer. There is no option available there. And so he will have to come around in accepting that Advaita also is a matter of experience. That's what you want to prove. It is not that you arrive at Advaita merely by reasoning, but that Advaita also is a matter of experience. Yuktim vikalpayari siddhanti vadayati vikalpasya nyunatam nyarakarate. Somebody says, why only two options? There may be more also. There cannot be more than two options. Either drishtanta is or it is not. Illustration is or it is not there. Prathamam paksham sopahasam nirakarodi. Suppose you present an argument without a supporting illustration, it is only laughable because nobody will accept such an argument. So like children, you know, you are the child. All right, come on, come here. Says no. Says why? Because, this is what they'll say. Do this, I won't do it. Why? Because, that's all. The child is not obliged to give any reason, you know. And still also very often we advance so many yuktis or reasoning or arguments. But how do you prove your argument? That's all. You must support the argument always in drishtanta or illustration. If you don't support the argument of drishtanta, the argument is not an argument. And that is what is being said in the verse 28. Nanubhutirna drishtantah, nanubhutirna drishtantah, iti yuktistha sovate, iti yuktistha sovate, sadrishtantatva pakshetu, sadrishtantatva pakshetu, drishtantam vadame matam. Drishtantam vadame matam. Na anubhutihi na drishtantah iti yuktistu sobhate. This is again the, what we call the sense of humor of the author. He says, you say that the experience also is not there and you are presenting a reason or a reasoning or argument without illustration, that looks very good. Means what? It is not good. The idea is, if you present an argument without illustration, it doesn't make sense. But sometimes, oh, what a wonderful intellect you have, you know, this is how they say. So that is to be a style of interacting. You know, the scholars used to sometimes interact this way. Oh, this yukti or reasoning on your part is really amazing, is wonderful. Oh, what a wonderful intellect you have. What a bright intellect you have. What a wonderful argument, you know. Then you should know that it is not a wonderful argument, you know. So, that's the kind of language that they use here. It is yuktis to shobhate. Shobhate means it shines. That this advaita is proven by yukti without illustration, that is really a wonderful thing. Meaning, such a thing doesn't make sense. If there is an argument without supporting illustration, it is not an argument at all. Otherwise you can just say also that if I throw a stone up, of course it will go up, it will never come down. Where did you find this? That's what I'm saying. But then, unless you show such a thing happens, you can't. That is not an argument. So when we make an argument, there must be a supporting illustration which is acceptable to both the parties. He says, no, I did it yesterday, I saw it. Well, where is it? You show me, you know. Just because you saw it, maybe in your dream that you saw it. Mm-hmm. Or you imagine, you know. Never, it's not acceptable. The illustration must be acceptable to both the parties. You can see how Vedantins deal with very solid grounds. That's why when people talk of things, you know, which are in the air, then they get confused, you know, they don't know what to make of it, you know. And so, everything has to be very systematic and logical. You might say that their life is not logical, you know, maybe. But then we can't communicate. In order to communicate, there is a certain manner in which the intellect is accustomed to understand. And that is how if you communicate, then alone the other person will understand, otherwise they will not understand. Or they will understand in a manner different from what I meant to communicate. So to make sure that the listener understands what I want to communicate, the speaker wants to communicate, it is necessary that the communication is accompanied with proper reasoning, supported by illustrations which are also understood by the listener. If I give illustration of some particle physics, you know, which nobody knows, then it doesn't make, that doesn't form, become an illustration. And therefore, the illustration must be a pot, or it must be cloth, or it must be a rope and snake. It must be something like that, which is common, which is understood by everybody. Otherwise, if you give technical, complicated illustrations, which nobody knows about, then also it does not serve the purpose. See the Tikaka, Advaita Siddhi Yuktyaiva Iti Vadata Anubhutistava Na Vipayate. So that you are saying that you don't accept that there is an experience of non-dual. Yuktistu Drishtanta Pradashanamantarena Na Kinchit Sadhayati. And if you say that you are proving the Advaita merely by reasoning without presenting an illustration, a reasoning or argument without illustration does not achieve anything. Ataha Na Drishtanta Hiri Uktihi Ayuktayati Bhavaha. And therefore, to say that I am presenting reasoning without Drishtanta, it is not proper. Then that was okay. There is a that I can prove the non-dual and there is a drishtanta or illustration. So second line of the verse is sadrishtantattvapakshetu drishtantam vadamimatam. If you say alright, there is drishtanta or illustration to prove the non-dual, please give us an illustration which is acceptable to both. Drishtantam vadamimatam. You please tell us an illustration which I can also accept, that is acceptable to both of us. So please give us an example or illustration for proof of non-dual, which illustration would be acceptable to both of us. Dvitiya vikalpe ubhayavadi sampratipanna drishtanta vaktavyaha itya sa drishtanta iti. Okay. So now he presents a drishtanta or an illustration for the proving of non-dual. Tarhi drishtante naiva advaitam sadhayami. So the opponent says that alright, I will prove the advaita or non-dual by drishtanta, by illustration. Iti shankate purvavadi. This is what the purvapakshi of the opponent says in the verse 29. Advaita pralayo advaita nupalambhena suptivate Advaita pralayo dvaita nupalambhena suptivade idichet suptir advaite tyatra drishtanta mire idichet suptir advaite tyatra drishtanta mire. There are certain verses which cannot be broken down, you know, and because there are sandhis. So now he says, advaita pralaya. We say that pralaya. Pralaya means what? Dissolution. A state when the whole creation has resolved into its cause. Or a state before the creation of duality is called the state of pralaya or dissolution. We say that the state which is pralaya or dissolution is advaita, is non-dual, he says. Why? Dvaita anupalambhena. Because at that time there is no perception or no perception or no knowledge of duality. Because the whole duality is resolved into its cause. Since there is no duality, therefore we say that what obtains a state of pralaya or dissolution is non-dual. This is called reasoning. What is the illustration? Where do you find that just that there is no perception of duality and therefore non-dual obtains? Where do you find it? He says, suptivata, as in deep sleep. So as in deep sleep, there is no perception of duality, therefore there is non-dual. And similarly also, in pralaya or in dissolution, there is no perception of duality, therefore there must be non-dual. You understand? Supti meaning the deep sleep is presented here as example or illustration. That in deep sleep, we do not experience any duality. Therefore, there is non-duality. And in pralaya or dissolution, we do not experience duality, therefore there must be non-duality. Just as in the wood stove, we see the smoke and the fire together. In the hillock we see the fire, we see the smoke, therefore there must be fire. So how the wood stove becomes the illustration here. In deep sleep, we do not perceive the duality and there is non-duality. In dissolution, we do not perceive duality, therefore the non-duality must be there. Pralayo dvaitarahito bhavitamarhati. Pralaya dissolution should be devoid of duality. Dvaita anupalabhyamatvat. Because there is no perception of duality in dissolution. Yoyo dvaita anupalabhyaman sasad dvaitarahitah. Wherever there is non-perception of duality, there must be freedom from duality. Yatha svapah. Just as a deep sleep where there is no knowledge or perception of duality, therefore there is non-duality in sleep. And so, in the pralaya or dissolution, there is no perception of duality, therefore there must be non-duality. This is what he says. He presents what we call the deep sleep as an illustration. As we said, illustration must be that which must be acceptable to both the parties. So when he presents a deep sleep as example or illustration, then we ask him, Nanu, evam sadayatastra svasuptihi drishtanta parasuptirva. When you say deep sleep is the illustration to prove the non-duality, is it your own deep sleep that you are presenting as illustration or somebody else's deep sleep, you know? Deep sleep means what? Is it your deep sleep that you are talking about? Then I don't have entry to your deep sleep. Therefore, it is not an acceptable drishtanta, understand? A illustration must be acceptable to both the parties. Now what do you experience in deep sleep? Your deep sleep. I have no entry there and therefore, I cannot accept your deep sleep as an example. Therefore, other option is what? Parasuptihi. Somebody else is deep sleep. Somebody else is asleep. And that is perceptible to both of us. He says that we present as an example. You know? That somebody else is asleep. Where there is non-perception of duality and there is non-duality. So that somebody else's deep sleep is presented as illustration. Adyetyasya paramprati asiddhatvena tatsiddhaye drishtantantaram vaktavyam. Since your own deep sleep is not perceptible or experienced by anybody else, therefore it cannot be presented advanced as an illustration. Therefore, would you have to say that somebody else's deep sleep is the illustration? He says yes. Nanu tasyaha parasupti eva drishtanta hiti dvitiyam vikalpa nashankare. Says here that okay, I say that the parasupti, meaning the sleep of the other person, is drishtanta or illustration. And so that is what is said in verse 30. Drishtanta parasuptischer. Drishtanta parasuptischer. Ahote kaushalam mahat, ahote kaushalam. Yasva suptim navetyasya, yasva suptim navetyasya, parasuptau tu kakatha, parasuptau tu kakatha. Tushtantah parasuptischet. If you say that parasuptihi, the sleep of someone else is a tushtantah. Ahote kaushalam mahat. Oh, what a wonderful argument that is, you know. So, this is how they say it. You are saying that the other person's deep sleep is the example to prove the non-dual. Then, that shows a great, a great intelligence on your part. Why do you say that? That means that I am not intelligent. That's what, you know, you are implying there. Parasuptehe tava aprasiddhatvena tvaya drishtandikaranam anupannamiri sopahasam siddhanti aho iti. Why do you say that? And he says, yasva suptim navetriyasya parasuptau tu kakatha. When you do not know what happens in your own deep sleep, then how do you know what happens in somebody else's deep sleep? So, to say that in somebody else's sleep that non-neuropathies, when you don't know what happens in your own sleep, how do you know what happens in somebody else's sleep? Then how do you present somebody else's sleep as an example of relaxation? Yo bhavan suptehe anubhavagamyatva anangikarana. Because you say that we do not experience non-duality. That means that you do not accept that in deep sleep there is an experience of non-duality. You have not accepted that. So when you do not accept the experience of non-duality in your own sleep, how do you accept the experience of non-duality in somebody else's sleep? Svasuptya vinaveti, when you do not know what is happening in your own deep sleep, tasyatava parasuptau kakatha, then what is to say about presenting somebody else's sleep as illustration? Parasupti jnanam na bhavaditi kum vaktavyam. The idea is that you do not know the deep sleep of someone else, naturally you do not know. When you do not know your own sleep, what to talk of the fact that you do not know somebody else's sleep? In short, your sleep or somebody else's sleep, none of them can be presented as drishtanta or illustration that is acceptable to both of us. Then he says, nano anumanat parasupti siddhi iti shankate. He says, no, but even though I do not know what is happening in my sleep, but I can very well infer what happens to somebody else in his sleep, you know. Anumanena, by inference, parasupti siddhi iti shankate. By inference we can prove that there is this non-duality in the deep sleep of someone else. How? Says verse 31. This argument, as I said, you know, keep track of it. Nischeshtatvat parasuptau, nischeshtatvat parasuptau, yathahamiti chetada, yathahamiti chetada, udahartus susupteste, udahartus susupteste, svaprabhatvam balad bhavet. Svaprabhatvam balad bhavet. Nischeshtatvat paraha suptau. Says, I can see that the other fellow is sleeping. Why? Vimataha paraha suptau bhavitum arhati. We say that the other person is fast asleep. This is inference, you know. How? Pranadimatve sati nischeshtatvat. That even though he is breathing, he is motionless. So this person must be fast asleep because in spite of breathing, he is nischeshtah. Without any cheshta, there is no movement or motion at all, and therefore he must be fast asleep. For that you must have another example. You see, whenever you present an argument, you must always present an example. So you now presenting an argument that the other fellow is fast asleep. Why? Because in spite of breathing, there is no movement in him, therefore he must be fast asleep. But where did you find the concomitance of the non-movement and fast asleep? Where did you find that? When you only find them together, that one is breathing and that there is no movement and then he is fast asleep, if both of these are experienced, then when you find somebody breathing and motionless, then you can infer that he is fast asleep. But where did you find motionlessness and fast asleep together? He says, madvat iti, just as in my case, that when I am fast asleep, there is no motion at all. Then I am asleep and this fellow is not moving, therefore he must be fast asleep. He came back to his own sleep, you know. Iti asti iti. Anumana rityartha. So, in proving that the other fellow is asleep, he presents his sleep as an example. But how did you know? How did you know that you are sleeping? Evam tarhi tava suptehe svaprakashatvam Parishasya Devyaha Siddhanti. See, you are presenting your own sleep as an example to prove that somebody else is sleeping. That means that your own sleep is something that is known to you. Otherwise, how do you say, how do you present that as an example? So, when you are presenting your own sleep as an example to prove the sleep of someone else, that means that you are accepting that you somehow know your own sleep. And that's true also. That means what? Svaprakashatvam parishishyate. That means that the experience of deep sleep also is something that is self-revealing, that you know it. When you are asleep, you somehow know that you are asleep, because when you wake up, then you say later on, you say that I slept well, I slept happily, I did not know anything. That statement shows that you have the experience of sleeping happily and not knowing anything in the state of deep sleep. And that is how that experience of deep sleep is something that is what we call known without any mind, without any sense organs, and therefore it is svaprakashaha, self-revealing. Udahartuhute susupte svaprabhatvam balad bhavet. Then you, who is presenting your own deep sleep as an example or illustration, it is proven per force that the deep sleep that you are presenting as an example is somehow known to you. And therefore, that experience is self-shining or self-revealing. Tadatarhi mam prati susuptim udahartuhu dushtanti kartuhute tava suptehe svaprabhatvam svaprakashatvam balat supti udaharana samarthyadev bhavet. And so, on the strength of your presenting, balat means here, anyatha anupatya, that on the very strength of your presenting your deep sleep as an example, it shows that somehow you know the experience of deep sleep, and therefore the experience of deep sleep is something which is svaprakasha or self-effulgent. And this is explained in the verse 32. Katham balad bhavati. How do we say that the deep sleep experience is a self-shining experience? How do you say that? Verse 32 explains that. Nendriyani na drushtantah, nendriyani na drushtantah, tathapyangi karoshitam, tathapyangi karoshitam, idameva svaprabhatvam, yadbhanam sadhanairvina, yadbhanam sadhanairvina. Na indriyani na dushtanta tathapi angi karoshitam. Says, in the deep sleep, the sense organs are not functioning, and you don't have even an example to prove that deep sleep is, that there is non-dual. And still you are accepting that in deep sleep there is non-duality. That shows that deep sleep is an experience that is known without any effort. Meaning, it is an experience that reveals itself. So it's a state that is known to us without any effort, without the bringing into operation our sense organs on the mind also, that experience is known to us. That means that the deep sleep is self-revealing. That is explained. Supti grahakane indriya. I have gone to sleep. Really, what goes to sleep is nothing but our mind and sense organs. Our personality goes to sleep. That person never goes to sleep, by the way. The person or the self never goes to sleep. He never wakes up. He never goes to sleep also. What goes to sleep is what is qualified to sleep, what is competent to sleep. So mind has competence to sleep, and mind is competent to wake up. Sense organs can sleep, sense organs can wake up. Atma does not, but that is not the point here. The point here is that the sense organs and the mind, both of them have gone to sleep. And that state is called a state of deep sleep. So, in that state, svagrahaka supti grahakani indriyani nasanti. When I am fast asleep, I don't have any instrument of knowledge. any conventional instrument of knowledge to know the experience of deep sleep. See, for example, when I'm awake, then I have the eyes, ears, my organs of perception to know the various objects. And so these same organs of perception, they perceive their corresponding objects. And my mind is behind the sense organs, so mind also perceives the sense organs, sense objects. In deep sleep, the organs of perception are not functioning, they are asleep. The mind also is asleep. So supti grahakani indriyani nasandhi. The sense organs are not there in the deep sleep to know the experience of deep sleep. Tesham svakarane vilinatvad. You know why? Because deep sleep state is called the causal state. And the dream and the waking states are called the effect state. Cause and effect. Like a lump of gold is the cause, and you make various ornaments, the ornaments are the effect. A lump of clay is the cause, and the pots and pans that you make are called the effect. When the effect resolves, the effect goes back. Like when you melt all the ornaments, they go back into their causal state, namely the lump. Or if you break all the clay parts, they go back into their causal state, namely the clay. And similarly also, what happens to my personality? What happens to my mind? What happens to my memories? What happens to all kinds of things that are in my mind, the sense organs? What happens to all of them when I fall asleep? All of them merge into what we call their causal state. So, there is no more an active mind. There is what we call a latent mind. Latent or potential state is there, not an active state. The sense organs are also in what we call the latent state, the causal state. And when I wake up, that mind which was in a latent state becomes manifest. The sense organs also which are latent, they also become manifest. This deep sleep is the state of, is a causal state or the unmanifest state. And the waking state is the state of effect or the manifest state. Tesham svakarane vilinatvat. The idea is that in the deep sleep state, the sense organs of perception are not there, with which I normally gain my experiences. Those organs of perception are not there because they have merged into their causal state. Drishtantascha sampratipanno nasti. And there is no other illustration to explain the state of deep sleep. We don't have any explanation, any illustration or example to explain the state of deep sleep either. In short, my sense organs are not available to experience that state of deep sleep, nor do I have any other example to show what happens in deep sleep. Parasupte aprasiddhatvasya uktatva, because I cannot cite somebody else asleep as an example because I have no entry to know what is happening there. Tathabitam suptim angikaroshi. Even then, you are accepting that in deep sleep there is non-duality. So, without an example and without the sense organs, you are accepting that in deep sleep there is this non-duality. Evam chasati sadhanehi vina vina sadhanam antarenapi bhanam meaning prakashanam idyadidameva svaprabhatvam susuptyaha ityartha. Say the second line, idameva svaprabhatvam yad bhanam sadhanairvina. Without the sadhana, without the means of knowledge, such as sense organs and the mind, still you have the knowledge of deep sleep. You have somehow the knowledge of the state of deep sleep, even though the conventional means of knowledge, namely the sense organs and mind, are not there, and still you have the knowledge of deep sleep. That shows that the deep sleep state is svaprabha, meaning it is self-effulgent. To know that which is self-effulgent, we do not require the conventional means of knowledge. As you said, to know that I am, I do not require the organs of perception. I do not require the mind. I don't have to bring into operation any means of knowledge to know that I am. Therefore we say that I am or existence is self-shining. Similarly also in the deep sleep state, We don't have the sense organs of perception of the mind, and still we experience a deep sleep state, because I say that when I wake up, I slept happily. The statement actually reveals the experience of deep sleep. So there is an experience without the means of experience that shows that the deep sleep is a self-effulgent experience or self-revealing experience. Therefore, you do not require any proof for that. You require proof only when thing is not self-revealing. You don't require proof when it is self-revealing. Atra ayam prayogaha. This is the way the argument is presented. Vimata suptihi svaprakasha. That deep sleep state is svaprakasha, is self-effulgent. Asatsvapi jnana sadhaneshu prakashamanatvat. Because even though the jnana sadhana, or even though the means of knowledge such as sense organs are not there, and still it is shining. Sankhya vimata atmavata. That's how the Sankhya say, Atma is self-effulgent. Prabhakara vimata samvedanavat. Prabhakara say that samvedanam, or the knowledge, is self-shining. Shakya vimata svatmavadidhi. And the Buddha say that the one's own Atma is self-shining. In any case, it is called the self-shiningness, where we do not have the conventional means of knowledge and still we have the experience. This is called self-shining. So, what is proven in all these arguments is that the state of deep sleep is an experience of Advaita or non-dual. And that experience is self-shining or self-revealing. This is a very important thing. So the teachers of Vedanta always present, understand that in Vedanta we are analyzing all the experiences. Our analysis is not confined merely to the experience of the waking state, but we also focus our attention very greatly upon the states of the dream as well as the deep sleep state. Because there is a lot to learn from that. There is a lot to learn from the experience of dream. And there is a lot to learn from the experience of deep sleep. For example, in Mandukya Karika, Gaudapada Acharya analyzes the experience of dream and shows how the waking state is not substantially different from the dream state. Here, we are analyzing the experience of deep sleep state. Why? It's a very important experience. It is by God's grace, or it is by the nature, by the work of nature, that each one of us experiences the deep sleep. And what do we experience? In deep sleep, everything is resolved. All my sense of individuality is resolved. All my problems is resolved. Let's say all the duality is resolved. And therefore, deep sleep represents an experience of non-duality. At the same time, in deep sleep, I experience happiness. Now that is going to be said subsequently. But why is that experience taken here? I mean, analyzed here at such a length is that in deep sleep, we also experience happiness. Because when we wake up, we say, I slept happily. And then the author will prove at great length how there is experience of happiness in deep sleep. And there is experience of non-dual in deep sleep. Therefore, the non-duality is happiness. And also, that represents my nature. Who am I? The deep sleep experience shows that that is a state where I am free from all the limitations. And therefore, my true nature is the one that is free from all the limitations of the nature of non-duality, of the nature of happiness. This is what the experience of deep sleep tells us. Even this experience of deep sleep is presented to show that self is of the nature of happiness. Because the happiness that I experience in deep sleep, what is the source of that happiness? I do experience a great happiness in deep sleep, because I always want that experience. Where does that happiness come from? There is no conventional source of happiness in deep sleep at all. There are no pleasurable objects, there is no music, there is no food, there is nothing there. No conventional objects of happiness are there, and still I experience happiness in deep sleep. What does it show? It just shows that Atma, the Self, is of the nature of happiness. I am experiencing my own self without any obstacle. The only obstacle is that ignorance, that's all, that I do not know that I am. Suppose in the deep sleep you are awake, that would be wonderful. If there are wakeful deep sleep, that's what we want. That's what they call samadhi, meaning that the conditions similar to deep sleep obtained in a state of absorption, where all the duality is resolved, and still I am not sleeping, I am fully awake. So wakeful deep sleep is an experience which will convince us that I am of the nature of I am of the nature of non-duality and of the nature of happiness. But that is something that few people have. But this is something that everybody has. Therefore, this is what we call an accepted illustration. If you talk of the experience of samadhi, then most people not having that experience will not be able to accept that as an acceptable illustration. But everybody has the experience of deep sleep, and therefore deep sleep is accepted as an illustration by everyone. And therefore, here the author has now proved that in deep sleep there is non-duality and that deep sleep is self-shining. Subsequently, he will go ahead to prove that deep sleep is of the nature of happiness. So we'll see that tomorrow. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyade Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyade Om Shanti 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 Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Badarayanam Sutra-bhāśya-krutau vande bhagavantau punah punah Īśvaro guru-rātmeti Mūrti-bheda-vibhāgine Vyomavat-vyāpta-dehāya Dakṣiṇā-mūrtaye namah Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om